Hey guys, Fru here. Welcome to my channel. Today, I will be answering one fundamental question: how to read books. Guys, so how do we read books? There are a lot of books that we can read. All these books are some of the books I could pull from my library, and I want to talk about today. This is a lot of books to deal with, and the big question is, in technology, in IT, we all have to read books. But how do you go about reading books? There is a way to read it, right? There are people that just open a book and they read it. And there are people that use a smart approach to reading books that gives them more information than the average person. And that's what I want to address here today, guys. So before we dive into talking about how to read books, I want to share with you a little story of a journey that I went on at one time. So back in about 2013, I heard about Hadoop around 2011, 2012. But I really started getting into it in 2013. So I did what the average person would do. I went to Amazon and I bought myself lots and lots of books, guys. Let me show these books again. A lot of Hadoop books. You can see them. Hadoop in Action. That's some Python. The Beginner Guide by Gary Tuckington. Hadoop in Practice. That's Manning. The Tom White Bible. The Hadoop Definitive Guide, a lot of Hadoop books. So I bought these books, and you can imagine just sitting down and trying to read all these books. But the question is, why did I buy these books in the first place? And then the second question is, how can you read books in a very effective way so as an IT professional, you get the most knowledge? Now, when I heard about Hadoop back in 2013 and I actually got into the field, I was missing something. I was missing context. I wanted to learn Hadoop, but I didn't know what I wanted to learn. I had no idea what this Hadoop was about. So just imagine, before I ever got this book, and I just heard of the concept Hadoop, what do I go out and learn? I had no idea what's in Hadoop, right? Should I be learning Peak? Should I be learning Hive? Should I be learning Scoop, Yarn, MapReduce, NameNodes, DataNode? I didn't even know what all these things were because I never seen it before. So the reason why I share that is because there are some people who like to learn by videos, right? What they want to do is, if there's a concept, they go online on YouTube, for example, like you're watching this video, they find a video on that concept and then they watch it. Guys, that is great. That works. I do it a lot. And, or you can read articles on the internet as well. And that works too as well. That's one way to learn. But the reason why I buy books and I have a lot of books like this is just a few of my books, is because books give you a table of content. So guys, if there's anything that you want to get from buying books, those of you who don't believe in buying books and reading books, and I'm saying this because a lot of people tell me they don't read books, they don't buy books, they have nothing to do with books. But there's a reason why books have been around for so many years, because it's a packaged knowledge for you to consume. Now, the reason why a lot of people feel that, well, they shouldn't be reading books and that books are boring and why would you ever buy a book and I don't want to have any single book, is because they've been approaching it from an archaic perspective. They've been approaching it from the way that you taught in school, that you open a book from page one and you're just forcing yourself and you're reading to the last page. Guys, this book in particular has over, talking about this Hadoop, the Definitive Guide. This book has over 648 pages. So this book has over 648 pages. So this book in particular has over 648 pages. Imagine having to read this and cover to cover. That would take a long time. And that's the reason why a lot of people feel that reading books is a bad idea, right? And not even getting started with the idea of judging a book by its cover. Like, you look at this, it's an elephant. Like, why would I ever go to a bookstore and pick a book like this? Because we've already judged it by its cover. So that is really what I want to bring here today, guys, and really tackle and share with you how I read books and some lessons that you can get so that you can read books more effectively. So there are a couple of things in books that you want to read. This is how I read it. I always, guys, let me do it with my own book. So this book is A Game Plan for Success in Data Analytics. It's available on Amazon. So I'll recommend that you check it out. Very useful book. If you want to get into data analytics, I provide 5 points, a game plan that you can follow and be successful in data analytics. It's a very quick read. You can do this in a night. So how would I read a book like this? I always have my notebook where I take notes. I have tons and tons of these at Field. I try to buy good quality ones. That way it does come in. I keep my pen here. I always have a page marker so that I can move it to different pages and I can write as I'm doing it. Now, once I pick up the book, and this is the book that I have. So guys, so once you buy this book, remember, you gotta get this book from Amazon. Your game plan for success in data analytics. The first thing in any book that is very, very crucial is people, when they buy the book, they just wanna jump and start reading it. But the first thing that I always wanna do is, I wanna read the intro of the beginning page of the book. I wanna read the dedication of the book. Did the author dedicate this to anybody? Or why did the author write this book? Are there any introductions? Are there any forwards? Right, because it just gives you an idea of who is this author and why do they have credibility for writing this book? Because I wouldn't spend hours of my day reading a book from somebody that I have no idea who this person is, or the person is not even qualified to be writing a book for me to read in the first place. So that those beginning pages, is very important that you read those. So once I do that and I understand who the author is, I'll go to the back of the book as well. And in the back of the book, there might still again be a more about the author. You can read the back page, who the author is, if there are any quotes. So for example, let me look at this one. If there are any quotes or any summaries or any takeaways from the book, sometimes you have it in the back. So I definitely want to read that, right? At this point, I'm not looking for knowledge. This is not giving me the concept that I want, but I'm just getting meta information about what to expect in that book. And by reading this, I can tell you that there's sometimes that, again, like I say, don't judge a book by its cover. Never do that. But there's sometimes that I just read it and I just put the book away because I'm like, this is not going to help me in the first place. So why am I wasting time 3-4 hours a day reading something that's not even going to help me? The author is not qualified. No one has vouched about the book. And where is this going? I have no idea. So sometimes I can easily eliminate books that way, right? Here's one secret. One of the best ways to read books and be more efficient is to be able to scan out the books that you shouldn't even read in the first place. So using this technique, you can easily scan out books. Now, assuming that we've gone through that exercise, I'll pick up a different book here. Assuming that we've gone through that exercise, let's get into the gold mine of what books are about. And this is what I pay for when I buy books. Literally, if there's one thing that I get from a book that I'm paying my money for, is this. It's called the table of content. Guys, that's what you're getting from any book that you're reading. The table of content. Sometimes there's a summarized table of content, and then there is like a detailed table of content the way this one has, right? So the table of contents is really what you want to go after when you're reading the book. And why is that important? Like I said, when I started trying to learn Hadoop, I had no idea of what Hadoop was about, what are the concepts in Hadoop, what is important in Hadoop. And even if I wanted to go on YouTube and watch a video about some of this concept, what would I search? I don't know what I don't know, right? So I'm just blank about what this concept is about. But guess what? This author, Alex Holmes, has done his job, because you're assuming that he knows what he's talking about, and he's figured out a summary of knowledge, a body of knowledge, and put it in here in table of contents. So you have a structure to follow as you're learning. So the table of content is very, very essential. As I'm going through the table of content, I'm looking at it. What are we talking about here? So here he's talking about Hadoop, background and fundamentals. Ah, there you go. So I can get some background and fundamentals about Hadoop, exactly what I want. Then I can look at moving data into Hadoop. Sure, is it important for me to understand how to move data into Hadoop? Okay, I want that. I can see big data patterns. Yeah, do I want to read about big data patterns and understand the different patterns in big data? So I can pay attention to that. Oh, data science, using data structures and algorithms. Do I want to pay attention to that? I can see that in the table of content, what I'm going to be getting. Right, predictive analytics. This is a little bit old, with Mahout. At the time, Mahout was a very big thing, but now we have Spark and so Mahout is really not that popular anymore. But so I can see these contracts, and let me switch to this other one. And that's the reason why I buy different books. So if you notice with Hadoop, guys, lots and lots of books. That's the reason why I buy a lot of different books like this, because by looking at the different content, table of content, I'm cross-checking my ideas, and what I'm doing is I'm saying, what concepts are common across this? Because at this point, I have no idea about Hadoop yet. So the last thing I want to do is put all my trust into one author, because some authors are good at explaining, some are not, and some author might just miss something because they decide not to put in their table of content. And if you put all your eggs in that basket, you might miss a lot of other things that some other content might explain. And this was especially true for these two books. This one was a lot of theory, the definitive guide and Java and the mappers and the combiners and the reducers. This book I really, and this book had something about Scoop, but I prefer this one for Scoop. The examples and the way they approached it here was just way more better for me. So even though I read a lot of this book, when it came to Scoop, I preferred this book. But if I had just bought this book, I would have thought, well, Scoop is difficult, or I couldn't get Scoop. Because this guy, I felt like I didn't get it from this book, but I got it way better from this book. Right, and I could make the same argument. This one was good with examples of big data projects and how they were solved using big data technology. So I got it from this book. By getting a diverse set of books, I can really fill in the gaps in my knowledge. So going back, when I'm reading the table of content, guys, in the book, I am filtering and looking for what is common across all these books, the way that I've mentioned. So I'm kind of filtering and I'm saying, this talks about, this one now we're looking at the definitive guide here. It talks about how MapReduce works. Well, so the question is, what is MapReduce? Do I even know what MapReduce is? It talks about it. This book talked about Hadoop in action, and it explained MapReduce there. Now, I can come in here and say, well, how does it actually work? This book now tells me that that question is answered there. Oh, now this one says setting up a Hadoop cluster. Guys, this book doesn't tell you that. But now here I can say, well, we've talked about Hadoop and big data, and now I know what Hadoop is. I can, if I want to know how to set up a Hadoop cluster, then I'm reading this chapter. So you really want to spend as much time diagnosing the table of content as you can, right? Pick, Scoop, case studies, really amazing. So once you have your table of content, then you can start talk about how do you read the book, right? But what I see a lot of people, the mistake they make is they just want to start reading and they haven't even looked at the table of content. I'm asking, what are you reading? They say, well, I'm on page 12 because I'm just reading the book and going, guys, that's not helpful. Why are you on page 12? What information are you trying to get on page 12, right? But by looking at the table of content, it gives you like a compass. It's like a roadmap, a guiding principle. You can say, now I'm trying to understand how to set up Hadoop clusters, because I've seen that in the table of content. Guess what? I just flip to that page, have my bookmark, and I'm reading how to set up a Hadoop cluster. And if that's all I care about when I'm done, I shut the book and I'm gone. Let's say I flip and I go to that page, how to set up a Hadoop cluster, and I'm reading and the author is not making sense and I'm not understanding. But in my head, I know that's something I really want to know, because now I have a point of reference. I can go on YouTube and search, or I can go on Wikipedia or Google or Dive or any place that you go to search. I can now go there and I search for information on how to set up the Hadoop cluster to supplement what the book talks about. So it doesn't mean that you have to go sequentially page by page by page before you get that information. So you can always skip forward, skip backward, you know, read page one and skip and go to the next chapter based on what you're trying to understand, and then pull in the information that way. But the table of content is what gives you that frame of reference to you. So to be honest, guys, how to read a book or how to read books, especially in IT, I should put it this way: how to read table of contents, because it's gold. And another tip too is Amazon is also amazing. Those guys are just amazing. They, on Amazon, when you're reading and you're buying a book, I have a whole library of books in Amazon that I want to buy. Of course, I don't buy every single book. But when you look at it, you can preview a book and they give you a summary of the table of contents. So sometimes I even get the table of contents summary from there and then know what to learn about a particular topic without even end up buying the book, right, physically. So I can say, well, I'm trying to learn Spark. I have no idea what Spark is. What are the concepts that are important in Spark to learn? Now I go on Amazon, I find a book on Spark. That's somebody that's written a book on Spark. I know that if you're writing a book on Spark, you've probably told me the important concepts and the areas that are in Spark for it to work. So I can take that, look at it. Now I go on YouTube and I'm like, oh, how does Spark work, or how does App Manager work, and all those things, how did they all come together? And then you can learn Spark that way. You have a frame of reference to learn it. And if you cross-check that across different books, now you have a broader perspective, and then you can go ahead and use videos or use courses or any other thing that you find relevant to then deep dive into that specific topic. So guys, this is really one of the topics that I wanted to make, because a lot of people have this notion that I don't read books, right? And they seem to use it as a bragging right. Like, why do you read books? Books is so old school. There's no reason to ever buy a book, right? If that's you, I understand it. I know reading, the people that don't just want to read. So if that's you, I will really understand. But as a means of getting information, and there are different reasons why we read, as a means of getting information, guys, you cannot beat books, because authors spend a lot of time to write books, right? To write a book is a lot of work. And what it does is it gives you a body of knowledge. It gives you a framework, the tailor content, so you can know what, so you can have an idea to know what to go out and to study. And the difference between reading books in technology versus reading books, say, for entertainment, like if you're reading a novel, it's very different. And I think people say that because they come from that idea where you go to school and they're forcing you to read all these books and novels and things like that, and it's kind of boring for most people. I think that that's where people develop that hatred for just reading books in general, or that reading books is for geeks, and you know, it's like school homework to go read a book. And then when you're not in school anymore, it's kind of like liberation. Yes, I don't want to read books anymore, and I have the freedom not to. I think that that's really part of what the culture has put us in that position, where people see reading books as a form of hatred. But to me, ultimately, I don't read books for the sake of just reading books, right? I don't think I get any fulfillment, any particular joy from waking up in the morning and say, yes, I read a book today and I'm so proud. There are people who claim to read a book a day, or a book a week, or a book a month. I'm not that type of person. To be honest, I don't like reading books. If I don't have to read a book, I will not go out reading a book. But the reason why I read a lot of books, or I buy a lot of books, is because I get value out of it. I need something from the book. There's no getting away from it. Like, I don't get any pleasure waking up in the morning and going for a run, or going to the gym and lifting weights and working out, right? And sweating and getting tired, and my body's aching. I don't get any particular pleasure from that, right? I would not do it if I had the means to not do it. But the reason why I do it is because I want to stay in shape. I want to be toned. I want to have look good and feel good about myself. And in that, because of that need, going to the gym is just a necessary evil that you have to do. So if I want to be knowledgeable, I want to understand concepts, guys, reading books is just a necessary evil that you have to do, whether you like it or not. There are people who have fun doing it. If that's not you, sure, you don't always have to do things because you get fun out of it, right? You know, get beyond the fun, be efficient. So pick the book, look at the table of content, understand that reading is not the end in itself, it's a means to an end, right? So you're not just reading for reading's sake, you're reading because you want to figure out what is relevant in this book, and then go out and do the homework that needs to be done. So by looking at the table of content, by understanding the author, you can also, some authors even leave their contact information behind in the book. So you can even take those information and reach out to the authors. That's something that people don't even talk about a lot, right? So if somebody writes a book on, say, Hadoop, and you know Tom White is an expert on Hadoop, and you're trying to get into that field, why not find his contact information behind, reach out to him on LinkedIn, and I've talked about this before, or Instagram, or Facebook, or Twitter. And usually it's better if you take a picture of the book and send it to him, so that he knows that you actually bought the book and you're reaching out with a question. Then that gives you more people in your network. So not only are you getting value out of it, not only are you supporting people, because it's a lot of hard work to write a book. I can tell you that after writing this book, and it's a quick read, it was a lot of work and a lot of sleepless nights to get this done. So going through that, I understand that authors appreciate if you buy their book and you say something nice about them, and you're thankful to them for it. And they'll connect with you on LinkedIn, and so you can grow your network, and they can answer your questions even one-on-one in that case, right? But you have to really be efficient with your time. Look at the table of content. That is like a gold mine of information. Take it, read what you want in the book, skip what you don't want to, what you don't want to read in the book, and then build the knowledge your own way. This is not a novel. With novels, you have to read from sequentially from chapter 1 to chapter 10 to understand what's going on, otherwise you miss it. But with a book like this, right, if my goal is just to understand how to set up a Hadoop cluster and I don't really care about how combiners work, why do I need to spend my time reading 100 pages on combiners or partitioners, right? Why do I need to do that? Or disaster recovery, if that's not what I really care about. And so because of technical books are not ordered in a sequential way, you can always move back and forth and still get the information that you need from any book that you read. So guys, thank you for watching. I hope my tip helps on how to read books, especially in technology. I hope that I made the case for you that books are something that are very important to have, that you should go out. If somebody writes a great book, make sure you buy it, like this book, The Game Plan for Success. I'm gonna keep plugging in this book because I really want you guys to make sure that you get a copy of it and support. I think it's great and it's gonna help your career too on how to get into data analytics and be successful. And then once you do that, you take the table of content, reach out to the author, reach out to me with any questions, guys. I'll definitely be more than happy to respond to your questions and to have a conversation with you. So thank you very much for watching. I'll see you next time. Be sure to subscribe if you haven't subscribed to my channel. Make more videos like this. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comment section below or just reach out to me directly. And I'll talk to you.